I enjoyed my vacation last week. Last Saturday, we did the wedding with the grandson of one of my close friends, Al Orland. He's dead now. You know Al, he's been there a number of times in the past. But the wedding went real well. But I do have kind of a funny story that could have been a disaster. Well, my wife's okay. She's not here today, but she's had it. But it was at the schoolhouse on Route 5, about a half a mile from my home. And the service went perfectly. And everything was wonderful until the close of the reception. And Diana and I decided that we would go home. And, you know, I have that bad toe, and if I wear school shoes for 8 hours, I'm in a lot of pain. So I said to Diana, I'm going to go up that hill. It'll save me about 300 steps. Oh, she says, don't do that. You'll fall. I said, no, I won't. Never expected that Diana would follow me up that hill. I got to the very top with my friend Al Irwin, and all of a sudden, I turned around, and there was Diana rolling down the hill. She followed me. Her arms were up like this, and her legs were straight. You know, we're going to watch Olympics in about a month, and I would give her a perfect 10 for her roll. I just wish I had a video on it. If I did, I would post it, because it was hilarious. After she got up, it was okay. She had some bruises, but it was fine. Then the next day, we went to Joe's graduation, and he gave one of the two graduating speeches from high school kids, and he did real good. And I was absolutely amazed. My family didn't tell me about this. They wanted it to be a shock. But when they called Joe up for graduation, he received the Harry Johns Elwood Avenue Church Scholarship. And I really appreciate that. That is such a tribute to me and my family. You know, Joe joined this church because he wanted to be the church I served. And they really went out of their way to give him that scholarship. And it really touched my heart. And if anybody at Elmwood hears this today, just from this old man, a deep thanks to a place I really love. We still pray for Mia every week. I wish I had been here to see your kids when they were here last week. That would have been fantastic. Anything else to report, good or bad? Well, let's pray. Our Father, we thank you so much for the privilege of worship, for the fact that we know you do care for us, that you love each of us by name. We pray that you will bless us this day as we worship, be present with us to give hope and to build faith. We pray that you be with all of our folk from this church who are ill. As always, we pray for Mia. We pray that you make this worship exciting, that your spirit move each of us this day. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
God's growth in times of transition and change. take the faith apostles' creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
God's action in communion with him. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed.
By what we have done and what we have left undone.
We have not loved you with our whole heart, mind, and strength.
We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves.
In your mercy, forgive what we have been.
Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be,
so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. Assurance of pardon. I announce the good news of the gospel. You're forgiven, but for the asking of your faith. Friday evening, it was at Joe's graduation party. It was
He was looking forward to eternity, and he knew that God who created everybody that ever existed will give people life forever. And he says, that means I'm going to have eternity to meet all of the great people I want to meet. And we were laughing how much fun it would be to see Abraham Lincoln. And my, I think that's true. In eternity, God gives life to people, and there's so many movies that will be there. And we'll have eternity to get to know all. Well, God the Father is the one that made all of this. And then I talk about Jesus. And Jesus is the one who saves us. And he did this by dying on the cross. And when I talk about God the Holy Spirit, what I like to say is that's God present in our world today. And I always challenge people to look for little moments in their life when they know that something is a gift of God. If you're not a believer, you would say it was an amazing coincidence. But if you believe, you say it was God. And God touched me at this point. I have a whole number of times in my life when I'm absolutely convinced God touched me. So God gives us the Holy Spirit as a guarantee. He gives it to us as a guarantee that God loves us by name, and that God will always be with us, and we will never, ever, ever be in a position where we are separated from God. And when you know that, that makes life a whole lot more fun. Our Father and God, we thank you so much for these young people and for the guarantee of the gift of the Holy Spirit. We pray, Lord, that you will bring them all back. Together, we will worship and praise your name. In Jesus' name we ask you. Amen. Thank you very much. Let us pray. Oh Lord, each of us in our own way, bring our cares and concerns. Almighty God, it is so good to believe in your name. It is so good to know that we walk every single step of every day in your presence, and that your love never leaves us, even for a second. We pray that you be involved with all of the people of the earth, that you will bring peace out of conflict, that war will be no more. To that end, bless all of the leaders of the earth. Give them the ability to make moral decisions that will enhance the quality of life. We pray that you will protect our president and those who make important decisions for our nation. We pray that they be wise decisions, and that through everything, democracy is strengthened and freedom is strengthened. We pray that there be peace on earth and goodwill among all people. Our military is so important, they keep us safe. Be with them on all assignments. We pray they not be hurt, and we pray they always come home in safety. And we ask the same thing for our firefighters and police who put themselves in harm's way every shift. May they not be hurt. May the reports of violence that we hear weekly in this nation be no more. May we learn as a people how to respect the dignity of all. We pray that you will heal the sick everywhere, that you will be with people as they make important decisions, that they be made correctly. We pray that you comfort the many who mourn,
be with those who pass through the valley of the shadow of death before this church worships again. We pray they have faith for eternity. We ask, Lord, that you bless all Christian churches. May each of them have a vision to know what they must do to truly serve Jesus Christ. We pray you bless the work of Adamsville. Be with us in all we do. Be with our Bible school meeting that happens after this service. Give us the wisdom, Lord, to be the church you would have us be. And may, in the end, we bring people to a saving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is our prayer. And we ask it in the name of our Savior to tell us when we say, is this a prayer to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
monthly session and trustee meeting immediately following worship service. And please notice we definitely are doing Bible school here the week of July 19th through 23. So if you know any little kids anywhere that might be interested, get the word to their parents and to the children, because we sure hope to have a fine, exciting time together as we celebrate our Bible school this year. We're going to receive our offering now. We're doing it as we always do until we get this COVID thing prohibited, right? And that's by just letting people, either as they come into church or as they leave, put their offering in either one of our offering plates that are here. Our Father in God, we thank you so very much for the privilege and the delight of being able to share our possessions with you. We pray that they will be used to carry out the work that the church will, both here and in the far places that we do serve. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Now let's sing the doxology.
Daily walking.
is taken from the 92nd Psalm, verse 1 through 4, and then 16 through 19. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to your name, O Most High, to declare your steadfast love in the morning, and your faithfulness by night, to the music of the lute and the harp, and to the melody of the lyre. For you, O Lord, have made me glad by your work. At the work of your hands I sing for joy. The righteous flourish like palm trees and grow like a cedar in Lebanon. They are planted in the house of the Lord. They flourish in the courts of our God. In our age, they still produce fruit. They are always green and full of sap, showing that the Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. And then, I'm following this day the lectionary, and so I read to you from the fifth chapter of the second chapter, or the second letter to the Church of Corinth, beginning with the 11th verse. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we try to persuade others. But we ourselves are well known to God, and I hope that we are also well known to your conscience. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you an opportunity to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast in outward appearance and not in the heart. For we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. But the love of Christ urges us on, because we are convinced that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, so that those who live might live no longer for themselves, but for him who died and was raised for them. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view, even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view. We know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. So in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ, since Christ is making his appeal through us. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to sin, to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Beginning with the 11th verse of this chapter, Paul writes about the fact that apostles or ambassadors have been attacked by the people of the world. And this just happened, hasn't happened once or twice, but it's happened in every century since both millenniums, since the Lord Jesus walked upon the face of the earth. Paul is thinking about the members of the church as he writes this chapter. He hopes his motives will be clear in the minds of the people who read the document. In other words, what he's saying is that God sees through to conceal from God or from them. Therefore, he asserts that the attacks of him are unjustified and they stand without merit. But for him to say this much means that he is running up against an embarrassment, because he insists that people must not glory in themselves. People are always to glory in God. Throughout his epistle, he insists that people dare not be self-righteous. They should not boast in their accomplishments. When he says, "My conscience is clear," this sounds like a recommendation of himself. Paul adds, "I really don't want to write this, but I have to give you an opportunity for glory on behalf of us, so that you might have something to answer those who glory in things and who do not glory in their own heart." According to Paul, the only human characteristic of true value is the heart. For him, the heart consists of an individual's inner motivation guided by love and by the principles of the kingdom of God. He warns that there are many people who give all of their attention to their possessions and to the individual patterns of their own personality. His principle is that wherever there is vain glory, there is no sincerity of faith. Then he makes a startling contrast. He admits that the Christian personality appears to the world as being irresponsible. There is no way he can gear the ethic of Christianity into the ordinary fabric of life. It just does not fit. This is a concession to his opponents. Then he makes two very important claims. First, that he is not concerned about himself, but only to serve God and Christ's church. And second, he is not at all afraid of what other people may think of him. He is ready to be thought of as mad, if only he can perform the work of God and of God's church. This always has been the way of a Christian. We live by an ethical ideal that just does not make sense to the person who does not know, comprehend, or understand the love of our God. Whenever it is I read this passage, I think of a dear Christian from my home church in Bellevue that I knew well during the 1950s. This person never turned anyone down in their need. She would talk to anyone on the drop of a hat. She was proud to let other people know what Jesus meant to her. She showed no distinctions between any human beings. Yet most of the people of the community believed that she was not exactly normal. You see, this person did not live by the standards of the world. She just was out of step with the rest of humanity. Yet she expressed the love of God as well as any person I ever knew in my entire life. Paul says that it is his love of Christ that sustains him as he attempts to live a Christian life, as he presents the gospel to an unbelieving world. And this is a decision that always is made by a person's faith. It is belief that Christ died on the cross of Calvary on behalf of all people, that gives us the strength to be Christians in the world in which we live. We also have the knowledge that when Christ died, we died with him. This means that Christ died for all in order that those who live by faith may no longer live for themselves, but they can live for Almighty God. This is the point where salvation finds its impact and its meaning. This is where people take advantage of the free gift of our God. The statement that they died in Christ means primarily that sins no longer are charged against the person. And Paul believed that the cross of Christ was available for all people in every generation that would come. It has the power to give forgiveness, and it has the power to give life. And I want to guarantee you something. If you truly believe in Jesus Christ from this moment on, your life will be totally different. For in the first instance, you will never see another human being from only the perspective of humanity. You will see each person you meet as a child of God, known by God, loved by God by name. You'll see each person you meet as the person that Jesus Christ died for. You will have a new vision of the significance of life. It is also true that while the apostles saw Jesus in the flesh, we no longer see him this way. We no longer see Jesus as he was back in Palestine during the 33 years that he lived on this earth. Now we know him as identified with the entire realm of humanity, especially with the body of Christ, which is constituted by believers of all ages, so that if anyone is in Christ, that person is a new creation. Paul is saying that we see Christ not just as a historic person, but we see him according to the Spirit. The Spirit comes to the organic body of humanity which is united with Christ in faith. And the Spirit of God belongs to the whole Christian body. This is why I root for all churches. This is why I want no church to fail. There is no such thing as a best church, and the sooner we learn that, the better our faith is going to be. For anywhere Christ is proclaimed, there the Spirit of God is, and wherever the Spirit of God is present, there could be amazing, magnificent, wonderful things that truly do transform all of life. It is true we no longer see Christ according to the flesh. We have a whole new vision. Everybody is a new creation. The old is gone. Yet, it is always true that with our religion, we become perverted by the love of the way it used to be. The past is gone. If you want to see and celebrate the past, visit the cemetery. The conditions of yesterday are no more, and we must face the changing reality of the present moment. The theological fact is that old things constitute the old religion, and the outlook that existed before Christ came into the world. But now Christ has been raised from the dead. The resurrection of Jesus Christ changed everything forever. Therefore, from now on, everything must point to the future, and it must not point to the past. No matter where we are on our journey through life, we must constantly think ahead to tomorrow. Put quite simply, tomorrow is where our God is. But of course, to do this, we must have faith. Only then does this great truth spoken of in this chapter become reality. In the 18th verse, Paul says, all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Christ. This means that Christ has turned his attention toward us. He has promised us the means of forgiveness. Notice, Paul does not say the church is the reconciling agent. He says God is the reconciler. This means that God has commissioned us to serve his kingdom. And how do we do this? In this chapter, Paul goes on and explains. He says God is the source of all things. This includes the course of nature and of providence and of history. God is behind the whole universe. And the God who is behind everything is the one who reconciled the world. What he is talking about here is that all things, the old and the new, have God as their origin. God is the one who reconciled. And the new message is that when we have been forgiven by Christ, we have guaranteed forever forgiveness. And the reason? Christ died on Calvary and was raised on Easter Sunday morning. Finally, serving the reconciliation means telling the message of Jesus. We have a responsibility of telling the whole world that those who know him have the guarantee of forgiveness and are now part of God's kingdom, just not for a little bit, but forever. How this works has been argued back and forth over the centuries. John Calvin, the founder of the Reformed Church, and we get our theology, a great extent of it at least, from his writings, said that justification was the act of not being charged with your sins, and sanctification was the state of regeneration by which people were granted holiness. This is not perfectionism. He says the believer grows in righteousness as the believer moves through life. The people always do continue to sin. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church, said that you are sanctified and made perfect right now. Wesley later changed his position because he recognized that once you have been sanctified, you still might have sweet weaknesses of the flesh and you still might commit sin. Finally, he said perfectionism was the deliberate policy to commit righteousness. I put it all a little bit differently. What I teach is that there is such a thing as a universal offer of forgiveness. When Jesus died on Calvary's cross, it was made for all of humanity. And there is limited salvation. Too many picture in our world today vision Jesus as a grumpy old man filled with indignation who just loves to point his finger in condemnation to somebody who sins. But that's not the way I see Jesus. I see Jesus with a big smile on his face. I see him on his boat with his disciples celebrating life. I do not believe for a second that Jesus was a pessimist. I think he probably was the greatest optimist that ever lived. Jesus loved all people. He loved both the sinner and the saint. And it is God, not humanity, who does the work of salvation. I believe that Paul, when he said he did not charge to them their trespasses, means that the death of Christ overcame all of the sin of the world. And all we have to do is accept this forgiveness through the asking of our faith and then strive the best we can for the rest of our life to live for the kingdom of God. This is because Christ the person put him into the situation where the hatred of the world was focused in on him. This is the way he took sin. This is the way Jesus became sin. Jesus was able to take into his own mind and body the hatred of the human race. He was God receiving all of this as a human being. And of course, the transcendent God cannot be reached by a human being. But the incarnation of Jesus means this is made possible. Because God feels the pain in the person of Jesus. Jesus truly is the pain nerve of God. And the miracle is that forgiveness followed all of this. And for this, I would say with great delight, God be praised. So, Paul says, because of this, we as believers become ambassadors for God. He begs us on behalf of God to be reconciled to God. He is saying there are two sides to our life in Christ. First, God did the work for us. And second, now we are to do our work for God. God reconciled the world to himself. Now, let us be reconciled. And we close with hymn number 730.